coming to one more present here. I take immense pleasure to welcome all of you. As a part of curriculum, our department is conducting a guest lecture in Principles of Digital Signal Processing to give a wide exposure in the subject to our students. Today, the guest lecture speaker is Dr. S. Ashok Kumar. He has received BE degree in Electronic and Communication Engineering from Anna University, Chennai, India in 2016, ME degree in Applied Electronics from Kannan Periyar Government Institute of Technology, Anna University, Chennai in 2009, in PhD in the Department of Electronic Engineering, School of Engineering and Technology, Pondicherry University, Central University, Pondicherry, India, March 2015. He has 5 years of teaching experience in several engineering colleges in Tamil Nadu. He is currently working towards the Associate Professor of Department of Electronic and Communication Engineering, Vertec University, Chennai, India. He has authorized for 2 books, chapters, and 45 journals and conference papers. His current research interest includes implantable antennas, biotelemetry, and telemedicine applications.
Let us share the ideas about our PC and the part of our department. What are the cases in electronics and communication engineering? This is the first subject, that is main subject for our electronics and communication engineering. In many of the subjects we have studied about the basics and their parts and problematics, what are the things. In five subjects, we have to study about the 20 applications point of view. But before we are going to start our applications, we have to study about the fundamentals of what are the numerical methods available in our part of the department. So in this case, the digital signal processing, we have to move on this topic. Why we are going to study? Why the circuit branches for EC, computer science engineering, IT department, and PUBLI. These circuit branches, students they have studied, must study about the TSP. Why they have studied about the TSP? What is the importance of our TSP? So whenever we are going to start about digital signal processing, first we have to study about our EC domain. The basics of EC. Without basics, we can't be able to understand our subject. So what are the case? In previous studies, already we have studied about it in first semester, resistor, inductor, capacitor. Without using the terminals, we can't be able to understand our PCB design concepts. Without PCB design concepts, we can't be able to know about the processes. It's like microprocessor and DSP processor. Already you have studied in the microprocessor and microcontrollers. So just you are having some doubts about the microprocessor and DSP processor. DSP also is one of the processors to implement some of the operations. So both are doing that operations. At what way it has to differ with each other? We don't know. We have to study about the concept. That's why we have to move for DSP. What is the advantages compared with microprocessor and microcontrollers? So it is also unique features compared with other processes. So now we have to start about the basics of our DSP and then at what way it has to implement, what are the applications it's having in our industry and real-time applications. So in basics, just we know about that signals. Normally we are going to give that input signal as continuous time signal. How we can say it is continuous time signal? Just take the example for my voice signal. My voice signal is our continuous time signal. But you are hearing my voice signal without, that is, with help of air medium. That is for communication medium. Right? That is carrier signal. So my voice signal is analog signal. How I am going to say it is analog signal? My voice signal is analog signal. How I am going to say it is analog signal? Already you have to know about the electromagnetic waves. Electromagnetic fields. Right? So in electromagnetic waves, what are the particles that are available in the electromagnetic waves? Already you have studied in the communication theory systems. Right? So in electromagnetic waves, it's having that both electric field and magnetic field particles. The electric field, with the help of electric field and magnetic field only, my voice signal is having that, that is my voice signal is the amplitude signal. With the help of magnitude response, it has, my voice signal can be moved to forward to some directions. Which direction I am going to speak? Suppose I am going to speak with forward direction, means the my voice signal is forward to forward direction. Suppose I am going to turn this side, so my voice signal will turn to some right hand side. Like way it has to move with the help of magnetic field. So in electromagnetic waves, it's having that both electric field and magnetic field. So in this case, the electric field and magnetic field, with the help of the electric field and magnetic field, my voice signal can be reached to you, that is receiver. I am the transmitter, I am the first person. I am sending some information to you. You are receiving that information. Right? So in between that, it's having some process. My voice signal is another signal. Another signal can be transmitted with the help of that mic. The transmitter is having that mic. It is receiving that signal and it has to communicate from transmitter to receiver. It is having some process. It is having some process. What are the processes are there? So here, the continuous time signal. This is my voice signal. It is a time domain signal, because my voice signal is based on that amplitude. So amplitude means it is a time domain signal. It is in terms of waveforms, because my voice signal is in terms of waveform. We don't know what is the amplitude of my voice signal, right? It is based on your air intensity, you are receiving my voice signal. We don't know about that amplitude measurements. So that's why we are going to measure that amplitude and what are the phase values. At what level it has to reach, at what distance it has to reach. So we have to calculate with the help of that digital signal. We can't be able to measure the amplitude for analog signals. So in this case, the continuous time signal, that is our voice signal, message signal, whatever the case, you are giving some input signal in terms of waveforms. That is for our continuous time signal. The continuous time signal can be converted into digital signal, that is discrete time signal. So discrete time signal means it has to give the waveforms can be in terms of samples. The continuous time signal, the waveforms can be sampled in each and every, that is it has to be segmented by samples with the help of sampling rate conversion. Already you know that sampling. What is the use of sampling? Simple concept. Conversion of analog to digital. Conversion of continuous time signal into discrete time signal. That is for sampling. That's it. How we are going to say, how we are going to define that sampling? With the help of this definition. Here we are using the sampling process. The continuous time signal into discrete time signal means, what is the sampling process there? So in the sampling process, what technique we have to use? For continuous time signal, it is time domain signal. The discrete time signal is in form of n, small n. Here, suppose you are going to use here sine waveform. X of t equal to sine omega t. Suppose you have to take an example. X of t is equal to sine omega t. For discrete domain signal, what is the signal? Here, x of t is equal to sine omega t. Here, in terms of n domain, n samples, we have to convert t domain into n domain. So what is the sampling theorem? The small t equal to yes. Small t equal to small n into capital T, where capital T is our sampling period. At what distance we have to take the samples? For example, we are going to take this sine waveform. What is our sine waveform? We have to take that samples. Right? At what distance? We have to take each and every samples. We have some distance, right? This is our capital T. And small n is our samples. We have to segment that. Continuous time signal. The continuous time signal can be segmented by use of, that is with the help of sampling process, and we are getting that sampled signal in terms of n. So this is our n, this is our t, this is our amplitude, here x of n, here it is x of t. So this is the first process. We have converted time domain signal into sample domain signal. So in here like this, in sequence system, you have studied this kind of concepts. Right? Already you have studied the definitions of signals and systems. The classification of signals and classification of systems. You have studied about the continuous time signal and discrete time signal. So now you know the technique to convert time domain sequence into discrete domain sequence with the help of sampling process. Now you are having that sample domain sequence in terms of n. So we are having here discrete time signal in terms of n. So you are having that signal. The x of n is equal to cos omega n or sin omega n or tan omega n or omega n or something in terms of inverse response, delta of n plus delta of n minus 1 plus delta of n minus 2. What are the signal? The signal, the input signal in terms of n, sample domain signal in terms of n. So this is your input in your syllabus topic. The first unit is discrete Fourier transform, right? So you are having that input signal as x of n. Now we are going to get that new digital signal. The continuous time signal is time domain signal. Already we know that time domain signal, my voice signal. Now my voice signal can be segmented into in terms of samples. Now we are having that signal as x of n in terms of n. Then we have to convert that is sample domain signal into this pure digital signal. We have to convert pure digital signal. How we are going to convert pure digital signal? In terms of transformations, we have to use that transformation to convert sample domain signal into pure digital signal. So here the n sample, the sample domain signal, n terms of samples can be converted into filter signal, that is frequency response signal or pure digital signal. For example, h of z or h of e power 3 omega. That is in terms of k. Here you are having the input signal as x of n. So now we have to convert from sample domain signal into pure digital signal with the help of transformations. Whether you can use Z transformation or Fourier transformation or Z transformation or Fourier transformation. In Fourier transformation, we are going to use that sample domain signal into frequency response, that is frequency domain signal. But we have to get pure digital signal, means we have to move for discrete Fourier transformation. So in discrete Fourier transformation, we are getting the pure sample domain digital signals. That's why we have moved for DFT. In earlier case, we have discussed for Fourier transformation and Fourier series. In this case, also we are getting the frequency domain signals. But in discrete Fourier transformation, it's having that pure digital, digitalized sample domain frequency response signals. So we are going to move for transformations with the help of that is frequency transformations. We are going to get the digital signal with the help of transformations. The transformations can be used for two kind of transformations we can use. Whether we can use for Z transformation or discrete for that is Fourier transformations. So in the Fourier transformation, we are going to get the few digital signal with the help of the transformations using DFT. Suppose we are going to use Z transformation. So in the Z transformation, we also get that few digital signal, but we have to substitute that z equal to e power j omega. That is z equal to r into e power j omega. In last semester, we studied about that control system in polar form. The real part, that is z equals to r into e power j omega, where r is our real part of the unit circle and e power j omega is space value support that is z axis. In z plane, that is already you know that region of convergence. In region of convergence, we are having that pure digital signal in terms of within that unit circle. The outside the circle is having that phase values, we can't able to that is take that values for outside the circle. We have to that is taken for only inside the unit circle. So we are having here digital signal. So with the help of transformations, we can use for either transformation or discrete Fourier transformation. So for discrete Fourier transformation, we have to use that is DFT and IDFT, that is analysis method and synthesis method. For analysis method is, we have to convert from sample domain signal into frequency domain signal. So with the help of that formula, x of k is equal. What is the formula to convert sample domain signal into frequency domain signal? With the help of DFT, x of k equal to summation n equals 0 to n minus 1, capital N minus 1, x of n, e power minus 2 by nk divided by capital N. So this is the formula to calculate conversion of sample domain signal into frequency domain signal. For synthesis equation, we have to convert frequency domain into sample domain signal. suppose you are having that frequency domain signal, then you have to get a sample domain signal. So that is reverse form. So we can use only the transformations which, that is x of n equal to, that is we are going to get that sample domain signal. X of n is equal 1 by capital N summation k equal 0 to n minus 1 x of k e power plus j 2 pi n k by capital N. The difference between analysis and synthesis equation, we are having, that is in synthesis equation we have to use that 1 by capital N. The e power value is the conjugate value for both analysis and synthesis. Right? So with the form discrete Fourier transformation, we are getting here x of k, what is for frequency response signal. In that x of k itself, we have to find that both magnitude and phase response of that signal. For magnitude and phase response, how we are going to calculate that magnitude and phase response of x of k? So in this case, we are getting that in terms of real part and imaginary part for x of k. Suppose in the results, we are having x of k equals to some zero sequences, some numeric value. The first sequence is having both real value and imaginary value. So in this case, we have to calculate magnitude and phase response with the help of your calculators in terms of order of real part, comma, imaginary part. You have to get that magnitude value, and then alpha tanf, if you are using, means you are getting that phase angle for that value. So in this, see, in university question paper, they won't ask for directly you have to convert, that is using DFT, you have to find the frequency response. Also you have to calculate both magnitude and phase response of the signal. So in this case, you have to find magnitude and phase response. In the answer, you are having both real part and imaginary part, means you have to calculate magnitude and phase response with your calculators. In terms of the option is available, the polar and rectangle option. Right, so here already the denoted as the transformation and frequency response. Here the x of z. The x of z also pure digital signal. When we are going to apply that z equal to r into e power j omega, means it is frequency response signal. Otherwise it is digital signal. So when we are going to use that IIR filter and FIR filter, we have calculated in terms of h of z. So h of z is our filter response signal for particular filter, whether it has Butterworth filter, shift-shift filter, shift-shift type 2 filter, or elliptical filter, or FIR filter, or what are the windowing method. So in terms of z means it is pure digital signal. In terms of k means what is the frequency response signal. So here, this is the formula to calculate the transformation. So one of the two more questions, it will come for what is the relationship between the transformation and discrete Fourier transformation. Here, the Z transformation, we have used that x of z equals summation n equal minus infinity to plus infinity, x of n z power minus n. For discrete Fourier transformation, same formula, summation n equal 0 to n minus 1, x of n e power minus n 2 pi nk by capital N. So just you have to equate that z power minus n and e power minus n 2 pi k n, right? Same thing only, just you have to substitute here z equal to e power j omega, then you are getting e power minus omega n. So just you have to relate with the summation as same and x of n is also same. The e power term only, it is varying. So you have to relate that relation. So this is the analysis and synthesis equation for our discrete Fourier transformation. For analysis, we can use this method by equation or matrix method. Whatever the case, you can use for based on your solving method. If it is easy for equation method, means you can follow that equation method. Otherwise, you can use for matrix method. The equation method is easy compared with matrix. Why? Means whenever we are going to use the f of t, DET and DAF method, the equation method can helpful to solve that equation the more cases. The most of the cases we have to use the equation method. Why? Means the equation method, we are going to calculate the e power of minus j pi by 4, e power of minus j pi by 6, e power of minus j pi by 9. So in terms of, we have to calculate the phase values. So in the phase values, it has to be helpful for our, in terms of, that is we are going to use the calculation in DET method and DAF. So it has to be helpful for in algorithms. So you can prefer to select the method is to solve the problems with the help of equations. So the matrix method also available. So in this case also you have to calculate the total factor values. Here, in terms of Wn power n into k. So already you know that total factors e power minus j 2 pi mk divided by capital N. It is also equal for W suffix capital N power values n and small n into k. So both the methods are easy, but in matrix method you have to calculate for all values. But in equation method, you have to calculate for only particular values because you are having an input signal x of n is equal to some signal only. That is, in terms of 4 signals are 1, 4 signals are 0 means you have to let out that remaining, that total factor values. But in matrix values, you have to calculate, that is, you have to find all values, total factors, and you have to substitute here, and then you have to multiply with our coefficients, input coefficients. So, this is the, maybe, most of the cases you have to calculate for more parameters compared to equation method. So, in this case, for this discrete Fourier transformation, we have to use two kind of algorithms, the fast Fourier transform algorithm. The discrete Fourier transformation, we have to use that lot of multiplication and additions. In fast Fourier transformations, we have to reduce that operations. We have to reduce that multiplication and additions with the help of fast Fourier transform algorithms. In that case, f of t, we have to use two kind of algorithms, DET method and DIF method. That is decimation in time domain, decimation in frequency domain. In decimation in time domain, decimation in frequency domain, both the methods we have to use the f of t algorithm only. So in this case, we have to use that is we have to save the number of additions and multiplications. What are the percentage saving? So also it is most comparable for DFTs. In f of t, it is the main advantage compared with DFTs. We have to reduce the number of operations. Just you have to take a direct compression, it is DFT. This is for radix to FFT, it is FFT algorithm. We have to compare that both DFT and FFT, the number of additions, n into n minus 1. Suppose you are going to use that 4-point computation means, you are using, that is, you have to use that 12 number of additions. Suppose in multiplication, 16 number of additions. But in FFT, you have to use that addition, that is, addition operation is only up to 8 level. The multiplication level is up to only 4. The compared to direct computation DFT, it is the better. So, in unadjusted examinations, they will ask. They have to give that, find the number of additions and multiplications for n equal to 64, n equal to 32. They have to give that n values. You have to use that n values into that formula and then you have to calculate that number of additions and multiplications for both DFT and FFTs. So this is one of the important topic for our DFT. See, most of the students, most of the classes, they didn't discuss about that power saving level for FFTs. So compared to DFT, the power saving level for FFT is more. Suppose you have to take that, see here, the number of additions and multiplication, they are used for add computation is n into n minus 1 for addition, n square for multiplication. Just you have to calculate the values. And then we have to use the power saving in additions. See, just your model is very important topic for our first student. Because most of the case, we don't know about that, how to calculate the power saving level in DFT and FFT. So just take out this formula. The 100 minus number of additions divided by number of additions in direct, that is number of additions in FFT divided by number of additions in DFT into percentage. We have to calculate that. Surely they will ask one question to one question from this topic. for both DFT2, FFT, and then into percentage level, into answer. So you have to calculate the percentage of additions and multiplication for FFT. How much power you are saving? How much percentage of additions and multiplication operations you are saving compared with parent computation? So in university question paper, surely they will ask this question. Now we can move forward. Just I'm going to give the brief idea of the calculator DET method for distribution in time domain. This or other, that is, just you have to see that code. In distribution in time domain, we have to use that, it's having some procedure. The first step is you have to take that bit reversal form. They are given that input signal as x of ns equals some 8 bit signal or 4 bit signals, right? So you have to take that bit reversal form using that bit reversal order. Already you know that bit reversal order, right? So in radix 2 means you have to take that 2. Suppose 8 point computation means 2 power 3. See, whenever the question they are asking, radix 2 means you have to use that radix 2. If it is 8 point computation means you have to take as the 8 can be converted in terms of radix 2. So 2 power 3 equals to 8. So using this concept, so 2 power 3 means we have to use the binary values that 0 to 111. So in this case, we have to use the bit reversal form. The 0 can be the bit reversal in terms of 0. 001 can be the bit reversal form is 100. The 2 can be 2 is same. 3 is 110. Here, this is our bit reversal form. In that bit reversal form, we have taken as input signal 0426 1537. So first you have to take that bit reversal form, then you have to arrange your input signal as bit reversal form, and then you have to compute 2 point computation with radix 2. So 2 point computation, you have to take, just you have to think about that, whatever the DAT or DAF method, if you are taking that 2 point computation means the first half is positive, second half is, that is first half is even signal, second half is odd signal. For whenever you, this is a shortcut method to remember that concept. For even signal, we won't take it as minus values. For odd sequence, we have to take it as minus 1. So first half is positive, that is even signal, second half is even odd signal. Whenever you are going to take that odd signal, you have to put it minus. Right? And then also you have to add the total factor in front of that operation. The W2 over 0. So you have to add the total factor in front of operation. Whatever the computation you are going to do, in front of operation you have to add the total factor. So just you have to compute these two signals and then you are getting some output. Similar way, you have to compute for whole entire 2-point computation, then you are getting some output. With help of that input signal, we are going to compute next 4-point computation. For 4-point computation also same. Here 4-point computation, we are having 4 signals. The first 2 signals are even signal, second 2 signals are odd signal. The first 2 signals are, we won't consider for total factor and minus values. For second half of that odd signal, we have to consider for minus values. And then we have to add the total factors for R signal 1 is W4 power 0 and R signal for second 1 is W4 power 1. See, whenever we are going to derive the derivation, with the help of derivation, we have to understand this concept. So now we can't be able to derive the derivation. So that's why I am giving that shortcut idea to remember that concept. So just we have to add the prudent factors in front of that operation, and then we have to compute the 4-point computation. Similar way, another 4-point computation also we have to calculate. With the help of this output, we have to calculate that 8-point computation. In 8-point computation, the 4 signals are even signal, second 4 signals are odd signal. So first 4 signals we won't consider for total factors and minus values. The second, the bottom of the 4 signals we have to consider for minus values and total factors. For 8-point computation, we have to take it as 4 total factors, W8 power 0, W8 power 1, W8 power 2, W8 power 3. Right? So similar way, we have to calculate that DAF method. In DAF method, the first one is 8-point computation. Then our input signal has same order. What are the signal is given by 0 to 8, that is 0 to 7. We have to take it as 0 to 7 as input signal. And then we have to compute 8-point computation. First we have to calculate 8-point computation. In this case, also we have to consider for even signal and odd signal. For even signal, we won't consider for total factor and minus values. For odd signal, we have to consider for minus values. The total factor can be multiplied with end of that operation. Right? Here we have had total factor for in front of that operation. But in TAF method, we have had it here. So this is for 8-point computation for DAF. So from that equation, we have to get again 4-point computation, 2-point computation. The final answer, it's coming in some order, we have to take it as bit reversal form. In DAT method, the bit reversal form is input side. In DAF method, the bit reversal form is end of that operation, last step. Also, we have to multiply with total factor in front of that operation as DAT method. At the end of that operation, we have to use the total factor for DAF method. So, also one more topic also important for our first unit in DFT, the circular convolution and linear convolution. The circular convolution, don't consider as circular method, you have to calculate for computation for DFT. And then, suppose you are having a signal, the x of n is equal to some 4 signals, for example 1, 2, 1, 2. H of n is equal 1, 2, 3, 4. So you have to compute for 4-point computation for x of n and h of n. You have to get x of k and h of k. Then you have to multiply with x of k and h of k. What is equal for y of k? Then you have to take it as IDFT. You have to get that signal as y of n. So y of n is equal, you have to get in terms of sample domain signal. For example,
suppose it's here L is equal
5, m is equal to 3, m is equal to 3, then, so 5 plus 3 minus 1, we are getting that 7 signal. So we have to get 7 samples for output side. So same thing here, capital L equal to 5 means, just you have to substitute here, same formula, x of k equal to summation n equal 0 to n minus 1, x of n e power minus n 2 by n k by capital N. Substitute the value, capital N equal to 5 here, for x of k. For h of k, you have to substitute capital N equal to 3. Then you have to compute these two signals, and then same thing, multiplication with x of k and h of k, then you have to calculate y of n. So next we have to move for second order, I of test. So already we know that, now we are getting it in terms of in terms of x of k, in terms of PAP and L. So with help of discrete Fourier transformation, we are getting now x of k. So in terms of frequency domain signal, right? So we have to filter out that signal because now we are having that some digital signal. So we have to filter out the signal. Why we are going to use that filter? Why we are going to use that filter? See, in your house, they are using some filter. Filter out some noises. So in our signal, we have to filter out some noises. Also, we have to improve our quality of signal, our original signal. So here we are having some original signal in terms of frequency sample signal. So in that signal we have to improve our quality. How we are going to improve our quality means we have to reduce the noise. So we have to reduce the noise with the help of the filters. So in our case, our DSP, digital signal processor, they have to use two kind of filters. Impulse invariance filter, that is finite impulse response filter. So IIR filter, infinite impulse response filter. In infinite impulse response filter, so the definition itself, we have to define that, we can say how to define that IIR filter. So impulse response, how we are going to denote that, that is define that impulse response in terms of symbols. Can you tell me that? H of n is our impulse response. So the impulse response of the signal is infinite. So summation h of n. The impulse response of the signal h of n is infinite. So n equal minus infinity plus infinity, that power minus n. So this is our IIR filter. So suppose in examination they are asking, differentiate between IIR filter and FIR filter means, just you have to define the first equation. H of z equal summation n equal minus infinity plus infinity, h of n, that power minus n. So the impulse response of the signal is infinite duration, that is called IIR filter. Suppose the impulse response of the signal h of n is finite duration, summation n equals 0 to n minus 1 or n, but it is having finite. So it is finite duration means it is FIR filter. Okay. So in IIR filter, see just in IIR filter, it is having some classifications. So normally we know that in filter, one signal is two types, that is analog signal, digital signal. With the help of analog signal only, we are converting the digital signal. The filter also, it is available for both analog case and digital case. For analog case, how we are going to design a filter? With the help of design, that is with the help of the filter only, we have to give that input signal, and then we have to get that filtered output signal. Right? So first we have to design the filters. How we are going to design the filter? It is also categorized in terms of another filter and digital filter. So in IIR filter, they have classified four kind of filters. First one is Butterworth filter, second one is Chebyshev type 1 filter, Chebyshev type 2 filter, and elliptical filters. So in Butterworth filter, Chebyshev type 1, type 2, and elliptical filters, they have designed with the help of that analog filters, they have designed that with the help of magnitude response of the filters. based on the magnitude functions, they have derived that, that is, they have to find that order of the filter and then pose of the filter and then design equation, that is transfer function of the filter. The transfer function h of z is our design, that is filter equation. Whenever we are going to discuss in the design equation, the h of z is filter equation. So in 10 more questions or 5 more questions they will ask, design a single pole IIR filter. Single pole IIR filter means, how we can consider a single pole IIR filter? Single pole. What is a pole? See, the numerator value is zeros. The denominator values are poles. H of z equal, h of z equal, zeros are numerator value, denominator values are poles value. So single pole means s plus 1, s minus s 1, that is for single pole. So whenever directly they are asking in single pole means you have to substitute as h of z equal 1 by s plus 1. Suppose second order equation, you have to consider as in terms of second order equation, s square plus s plus 1. Third order, s cube plus 2s, something it has to come in. So poles are denominator value, zeros are numerator value, right? So in IIR filter, we have to design the analog filter and digital filter. For analog filter, we are having some design procedures are there. And digital filters, we have to use the transformation technique from analog to digital conversion. So the transformations are available for in Butterworth filter and Chebyshev filter. We have to use that impulse invariance, that is impulse invariance method, bilinear transformation method, approximation derivative methods. So three methods are available to convert analog to digital domain. Right? Already you know that impulse invariance method, bilinear transformation method, impulse invariance, that is approximation derivative method. So, in finally we have to design that IIR filter in terms of h of z format. In h of z, we have to draw the structures with the help of direct form 1 structure, direct form 2 structure, cascade form, parallel form, and then lattice, that is ladder and wave digital structures. So, in our syllabus we are having, that is 4 kind of filter designs we have studied, right? Direct form 1, direct form 2, cascade and parallel form structures. That's it. Already you know that one. The direct form 1 structure, we have to design, that is self of y of z divided by x of z. We have to take the form in terms of y of z divided by x of z. For direct form 2 method, we have to take it as, we have to consider that h of z equal to y of z divided by w of z divided by x of z. Therefore, and cascade form realization, with the help of direct form 2 structure, we have to draw the structures for cascade form realization. So we have to split up for the h of z in terms of h1 of z, h2 of z, up to hn of z. Suppose you are having the transfer function in terms of third order filter equations means you have to take it as h1 of z, h2 of z, h3 of z. So you have to draw the structure with the help of parallel form 2 structure. You can draw the cascade form realization. For parallel form realization, suppose you are having say third order design equation, h3 and h of z equal to three kind of h of z, right? So now you have to take it as partial fraction. Then you have to calculate for h1 of z plus h2 of z plus h3 of z. Then you have to draw the computation with the help of direct form 1 method. For cascade form realization, you can use for direct form 2 method. For parallel form realization, you can use for direct form 1 method. So, for in analog to digital domain, we can use here the approximation derivative methods. So, wherever the h of s, that is s term, is available, we can use for 1 minus 1 by z divided by t, right? 1 minus z inverse divided by t. They are given here 1 minus 1 by z. So 1 by z is z inverse. 1 minus z inverse divided by t. Wherever the s term is coming for another domain, you can use for 1 minus z inverse divided by t means it has to automatically converted in terms of h of z. So that is for approximation derivative methods. So we can define the definition. The left half of that plane, the S plane, can be converted into right side of that unit circle. This is the definition for our approximation derivative. So here, that is for bilinear transformation method. The left half of the S-plane can be converted into unit circle of our Z-plane. That is called bilinear transformation. Here it's having both pre-working and pre-working method. So in this case, we have to use the S values. S is equal 1 minus Z inverse divided by 1 plus Z inverse. 2 by T of 1 minus Z inverse divided by 1 plus Z inverse. We have to use that term. So see here in Butterworth filter, the Poisson type is very very difficult to understand that whether it is, they are given the values in terms of analog domain or digital domain. We don't know. How we are going to know that it is analog specification, it is digital specification means the Poisson type they are given in terms of, this is for attenuation constant. In Poisson type, they are given in terms of attenuation, the unit is dB means directly you can take it as alpha P alpha S. The alpha P is our passband frequency, alpha S is our alpha P is our attenuation constant for passband, alpha S is for attenuation constant for stop band. For it is for analog omega P and here it is for digital omega. So the both the omega they are given for in terms of radius per second. The unit for radius per second, but in some times they are given L1, L2 value and analog frequency values. Some questions they are given because we have to confuse something. And we have to get, that is, we can't even know about that whether it is coming for digital or analog. Something we are confusing in the stage. So just we have to clear about that analog and digital specifications. Here it is analog domain, alpha P alpha S. Attenuation means it is analog domain. Here it is they are given in terms of ripples. The passband ripple, stop band ripple. Here they are given as passband frequency, stop band frequency. But in Poisson type, they are given in terms of kilo X means. The frequency they are given in terms of kilo X means, we have to take it as digital omega P equal, digital omega equal to 2 pi f. Digital omega equal to 2 pi f. Then we have to take it as whether the question is deals with analog filter design means, directly you can take it as analog omega. The question is deals with in terms of digital filter design means, you can take it as digital omega equal to 2 pi f. Then you have to convert for analog omega. So here the question type is design a digital Butterworth filter. Design an analog Butterworth filter means you have to take it as analog omega p equal to 2 pi f p. Analog omega s is equal to 2 pi fs. Suppose the question, design a digital Butterworth filter means you have taken as digital omega p equal to 2 pi fp, digital omega s is equal to 2 pi fs. And then you have to find that analog specifications. How to calculate that analog filter specifications? In question type itself, the alpha p equal to minus 20 log omega L1. Alpha s is equal to minus 20 log omega L2. Here, whether the design a Butterworth filter with help of bilinear transformation means bilinear impulse invariance method. What are the case? You have to take it as alpha p equal to minus 20 logarithmic of L1. The attenuation constant in terms of ripple 0.1 or 0.5 or 0.7 in terms of numeric values means you have to take it as it is L1, L2. Passband ripple means you have to take just L1, stopband ripple means L2. So you have to convert the ripple into attenuation value, alpha P and alpha S value, using this formula. Once we have calculated alpha P and alpha S, we have to calculate for analog omega P and analog omega S. Here the analog omega, how we are going to calculate the analog omega P for impulse invariance method. The impulse invariance method, it is equivalent for analog omega p equal to digital omega p divided by t. This is for impulse invariance method. So once we are getting that digital omega using this value 2 pi f, then easily we can calculate that analog omega 2 pi f divided by capital t. In question itself, the design of Butterworth filter with t equal to 1 second or 0.1 second, what are the values they will give. Otherwise you have to take it as 1 second. So analog omega equal to digital omega. This is for impulse invariance method. For bilinear transformation method, using the pre-warping method, so analog omega equal to 2 by t of tan of digital omega by 2. Whether it is passband means you have to take it as here omega p. Here also omega p. Whether it is stopband means you have to take it as it is omega s. Here also omega s. Right? So now you have calculated analog specifications for frequency domains. another omega p and another omega s. Then you have to calculate the orthogonal filter, capital N. So using the formula, N is greater than or equal to logarithmic of 10 power 0.1 alpha s minus 1 divided by 10 power 0.1 alpha p minus 1 whole divided by 2 log of omega s divided by omega p. Right? Then we have to find that Bose value, whether it is in Butterworth filter, it is constant for up to, that is we have calculated. For first order filter means h of s is equal to 1 by s plus 1. Second order filter means h of s is equal to 1 by s square plus s plus 1. Third order filter means 1 by s square plus 2s plus 1 into s plus 1. Right? For second order filter, s square, 1 by s square plus 2s plus 1. And third order filter, h of s is equal to 1 by s plus 1 into s square plus s plus 1. And fourth order filter is having 2 order filters. Like here, you have already it is constant values, just you have to know that transfer functions for up to 7, because the our problem Butterworth filter design methods, it is based on up to 7th order filters. You have to know about that h of s values. So here in the definition, we are having the Butterworth filter. How we are going to differentiate with Butterworth filter and Chebyshev filter means the Butterworth filter, the monotonically equal for, that is equal for both passband and stop band. The both passband and stop band, it is a monotonic response. For both passband, it is the passband range. Up to omega p, it is passband range. And after that, omega s, it is stop band range. So for both passband and stop band range, it is monotonic response. For Chebyshev filter, the equal ripple in passband, the stop band is monotonic response. That is for Chebyshev filter. So here, this is the magnitude response of our Butterworth filter. So in two more questions, they will ask, draw the magnitude response of Butterworth filter or write the magnitude response equation for Butterworth filter. The magnitude response equation is h of another j of j omega equal to 1 divided by 1 plus omega divided by omega c whole power 2n whole power of 1 by 2. So that is the magnitude response for IIR filter. Similarly, you have to know about that. Based on the magnitude response only, we have calculated order n. So here it is, from that magnitude response equation, we have calculated the order n. Here they are given in terms of ripple values, but we have derived that in terms of analog specifications. Here in terms of ripples. And here it is the Pohl's value, that is we have calculated the first order filter, second order filter for S1, S2, S3, so we have to calculate the difference. So from that example, we have to know that whether the problem they are given, the format is which format. See, just you have to know about that, let us see the two figures. Whether they are given the values in terms of alpha p, alpha s, or L1, L2, which format they are given? See, just to see the two figures, we have to find out the specifications. This is the problem. Design a Butterworth filter, right? They are given. Whether it is alpha p or alpha s. See, just you have to take it as, how we are going to find alpha p means, the alpha p that is, it is based on 0 to omega p value, right? So 0 is less than or equal to omega, is less than or equal to omega p. Up to that range, it is passband condition, where passband region. So here also they are given 0 is less than or equal to omega, is less than or equal to omega p. So the figure, the second picture can show that this equation, because directly they are given in terms of digital omega. So here we have discussed in terms of digital omega. So the second figure only that is suitable for this problem, right? So now we can take it as this is the passband equation, because the limit is from 0 to omega p. So here 0 to omega p is passband region. So first equation is omega, that is passband ripple values. So here the passband ripple, here the del 1 to 1, the del 1 to 1 region is passband. The del 1 to 1 region is passband, which is passband region. So this is our Dell 1 up to 1. See, just you have to see the figure, we can easily understand that ripple values. So this is our Dell 1. Similar way, we have to find that Dell 2 to Dell values. Here, the S of the omega is up to Dell 2. This is our Dell 2 value. Here, this is our omega S value. Omega S to omega. Here also the omega S to omega. This is our stop and reach. So omega S value is 0.3 into pi. From this equation, we have to calculate that analog filter coefficients alpha p, alpha s, omega p, omega s. Then you have to substitute the formula to find that order and then transfer functions. See, one more cell. One more confusion also will arise in that cell. We are getting that n is greater than or equal to here 5.8. So we can round up the value 6. Suppose we are getting that n is greater than or equal to 1.05. It is coming under in terms of decimal value. After that digit, you have to consider as next value. So don't think about it is equivalent for 1 or it is equivalent for 2. Don't consider like that. So it is, that is across that, that is across that limit, that is around that value, you have to take that next value. So here the given in terms of that is n equal to 6. So this is the constant. Already you know the transfer function equation. Right? For in this problem, here they have been given for in terms of that is frequency in terms of radius per second. Here they have given the frequency in terms of hertz. So what is you can take it as f, fp and fs. Fp equal to 2 pi f, that is omega equal to 2 pi f for both password and stop values. The pi 100 is in this problem, they didn't given whether it is with passband or stop band. How we are going to choose with this passband and stop band? How we can choose? How we can choose with this passband and stop band? So just you have to draw the magnitude response graph. On board we have graph, right? So lower value is passband, higher value is stop band. Same thing, alpha p and alpha s. So then we have to take this 3 dB and 40 dB. 3 dB is our alpha p, 40 dB is alpha s, and omega p is 500 hertz, sorry, 2 pi f, fp is 500 hertz, fs is 1000 hertz. So then you have to convert digital and all of omega input, because here they have given also digital low pass filter, that's it, they didn't mention any whether it is digital or analog. So you have to take it as analog low pass filter. So in Chebyshev, both Butterworth filter and Chebyshev filters are same for that procedure. For Butterworth filter, we are having that monotonic response for both passband and stopband case. For Chebyshev filter, the monotonic response is available for only stopband. The ripple concept, that is equal ripple, is available for passband. Here it is having n is odd, n is even. The odd signal, even signal. It is based on that whether it that is same it is n is odd, n is even. We have to calculate that n values also. We are going to use the design a Chebyshev filter. Whether it is odd means we have to use a different transfer function. Whether it is even means we have to use a different transfer function. So it is based on that even and odd signal. So this is the magnitude response of our Chebyshev filter. In two more questions, surely they will ask whether they will ask either Butterworth filter or Chebyshev filter. So this is the transfer function for Chebyshev filter, 1 by divided by epsilon square TNS our Chebyshev polynomial, omega divided by omega p. Okay, students, we have to take as this omega in terms of pass band means we can consider as omega p. Suppose we are going to discuss in stop band means we have to consider as omega s. With help of this concept, we have to find the capital N, order N. So here, this is our magnitude response graph. The equal ripple available in our pass band case. This is our pass band region. And this is for our stop band region. The ripple case is available for only pass band. Based on the ripple, it has to start from here, means the receiver signal. It has to start from 1 to the range, means it is R0. That is N is R, N is 0.